Welcome to the Music for the Soul podcast, where we talk honestly about difficult things. This is a place where music, hope, and healing come together. I'm Becky Nordquist.
And I'm Steve Seiler. Today we have with us Gloria Gaither. And if we shared her accomplishments, we wouldn't have time for any conversation. But I do want to say just a few things, if there by chance could be listeners who don't know some of this. Gloria is a songwriter who has had over 700 songs recorded, won multiple Dove Awards, multiple Grammys. She and her husband, Bill, were named Christian Songwriters of the Century by ASCAP. So that's impressive. And she's also an author of over 40 books. And I could go on and on and on, but let's just get started with the conversation. Welcome, Gloria.
Good morning.
I have to say, she's also one of my favorite people. She's just been impressed on my heart, and I'm just so glad to have this conversation with you today. And thank you again so much for taking time out of your busy schedule and your day to have some time with us.
Well, my busy schedule today actually involves putting a puzzle together with Bill, because we're both home, and our little dog Windsor does not like it when we do puzzles, because he brings us every toy he has, like, hello, I'm still here. Why are you doing that puzzle?
Yes, Windsor, the adorable dog who is high needs, right?
So yeah. I have to ask, are you guys 1,000 piecers or 500 piecers? What is your...
You know, my patience doesn't really go to 1,000. I like to get it done. And I'll tell you where I draw the line in the dirt on puzzles. If there's a whole lot of sky that is all one shade, there's no clouds, there's no variation, there's... I just like, I'll do everything else. You do the sky. I'm not doing it.
Division of labor.
There you go. I love it. Wisdom. No, that's just wisdom again.
I love puzzles that have little squares of other things. And by the way, we just did a Windsor puzzle. So I should send you both our Windsor puzzle, which is fun because it's got little snapshots, pictures of Windsor all around the puzzle. So you can do sections. I like being able to do sections of puzzles and get them done. Bill likes to do the border. So I was like, okay, I'll give you all the border pieces and you give me all the little sections of color. I like to match colors. So we're a pretty good team, although he doesn't like me to hoard my pieces, and I have to if I'm going to do a small picture. It's like, he says, you're hoarding all the pieces. I said, I don't have any edges. Just get off it.
Teamwork. See, this is going to be an all-inclusive episode, because we're going to talk about working together in marriage. We'll talk about music and how to do a puzzle properly.
Puzzles are great because our daughter was just home, Amy, and puzzles are great because we talk our heads off and then we stop. And then sometimes it can just be awkward, like, okay, what next do we need to talk about? But with puzzles, you can be silent for a long time, and then you think of another topic, and you zoom off in a conversation. But in the meantime, you're working on something together. And our daughter Suzanne just wrote a book on puzzles and personalities. So yeah, it's kind of a thing.
Oh, well, as long as we're on puzzles, I just want to say one thing. I have a friend, Corey, who does some live presentations, and he told me about this idea at a live event of putting one puzzle piece at every place setting, and then later on tied it into the idea of, without our individual unique gifts to the world, God's puzzle is incomplete. Even though we can't see the whole picture when we're only holding one piece, our piece matters, because if it's missing... And the picture isn't complete.
Yeah.
I love that. That's absolutely true. I would love to talk about how your puzzle piece, Gloria, has impacted the world today. But I also would like to know how you got started. That's something I love to ask people, is, did you always want to be a songwriter? Was there some other career when you were younger that you kind of dabbled with, or did you always know? Was music always there? You're an incredible lyricist, and you have a wonderful way of words. So I just wanted to ask how it all began.
I grew up with a writing mother, and my dad was a pastor, but he was a researcher, and he loved connecting the dots in scripture, Old Testament, New. He used to say, if you're not a good Old Testament scholar, you're not a good New Testament Christian, because so many dots end up, every dot in the whole book of Genesis, Jesus is through it all. And if you don't know the connections, at least you're cheating yourself of amazing joy, but also of deep understanding, because I think everything that made the book, I'll say it this way, I think the Jews are the best keeper of history that we know, and historians have used the Bible for centuries. Doubters have said, well, we went to Israel and we didn't find this or that. Then they dig down seven more layers and they say, oh, there it is. So is the Bible factual? Yes, I think so. But I think every one of those facts, historical facts, made the book, because it is also a metaphor, all of it, of our own spiritual journey. So if you stop at just the facts, you're cheating yourself.
Yes.
And those facts end up with Christ. They are heading toward Christ. So my dad loved that. He was a connector of dots like that. And our conversation at the table, Becky, often was him getting excited. I mean, from the time I was a little girl, coming in for dinner at around our table and saying to my mother, oh, you can't believe what I discovered today. And her saying, oh, Lee, I just read this today. Is this amazing? And they were connecting the dots of scripture. And it's a never-ending journey and a fun one, you know. So that excitement was always there. Mother was a writer and a speaker. Daddy pastored, but she spoke outside the church. She spoke in many events, women's events and missionary events. And she wrote for a lot of our publications. So I grew up with her loving words. So from the time I was a little girl, I loved that piece. When I went to college, I felt a call to some kind of ministry. And at that point, you know, people said, well, you could be a minister's wife. You can't be a minister, of course. You can be a minister's wife, or you can be a missionary. And our table was full of missionaries and theologians. And fortunately, I had parents who didn't think kids should be seen and not heard. They thought we should be heard if we had something to say. Mm-hmm. So from the time I was probably four on, my biggest ambition was to have something important to say at the dinner table when we had missionaries from Japan and from Africa and from all over the world, and theologians from the seminary and a lot of thinkers. And that conversation was always, and to this day, I love this, what we're doing. I love this kind of conversation that goes beyond the surface. When I got to college, I was offered scholarships for speech. I won the State Michigan Speech Contest the year I was a junior and went to Washington, met Eisenhower, and had my representative put my speech in the Congressional Record. And so that opened some doors to scholarships in forensics, speaking, and news. So I thought about being the first Barbara Walters. There wasn't one then.
Wow.
It was before Barbara Walters. And so I considered seriously a scholarship offer to two different universities in that area. But in the end, what won out was our dining room table. And I decided to prepare to be a missionary to Africa. So because so much, many of the African dialects have a French base because of the colonization from France and England, I majored in French and in sociology, and to prepare to be a missionary to Africa, I thought. And I sort of told God, okay, I gave you two. Can I also major in English? Because I love it. And he didn't say no, so I did.
So a major.
Wow. Awesome. So I had three majors and a minor in education and to teach. And so somewhere along the way, I met Bill Gaither. And my journey to Africa took an abrupt turn. So yes, I always wrote, but I really never thought about being a lyricist until I met him. And right away, you know, he'd have an idea. And he's like, I don't know exactly where to go with this. And I'd do a verse or reshape the chorus or whatever, because he had written some good songs, including I've Been to Calvary and Joy of Serving the Lord and a lot of things that the groups had recorded. But he felt like he was lyrically limited, let's say. So it was not a professional marriage. It was just a natural thing, as it's what I did anyway. And gradually, you know, it became, you know, the words and the music.
Hmm. That's so beautiful. Wow, what a story. I hear in that some humility on Bill's part to realize that maybe his wife had a better handle on the words than he did. That's pretty impressive.
Well, I think it's been a mutual admiration. Bill will put down his music, say, my music is simple. And I said, no, your music is amazing. With musical theory came from a history of what is pleasant to the human aesthetic. Mm-hmm. What does the human experience say that is beautiful? And so gradually these rules of music writing that we call theory mm-hmm. have evolved. Because things that are going, you know, that are dissonant, that make you feel agitated, mm-hmm. there's a reason for that.
Yes.
And sometimes that's exactly what you need. If you want disturbance, mm-hmm. you know, the 1812 Overture comes after all the war music.
Mm-hmm.
Finally, mm-hmm. it evolved into that wonderful piece. So to say that Bill was really a student of harmonies and theory. He got straight A's in that. He had to work at his other subjects because he was so, you know, he's one of those people that if he's in the studio, he's alive. Yeah, very focused. He's ADHD on everything else. but not in the studio. You know, he's like a arrow in the studio. Anyway, so all of that, his music is harmonically beautiful. And I think his most beautiful melody, my opinion, is something about that name. And it is very simple, but you can't get it out of your mind because of that. Mm-hmm. And to me, it fits like a glove, which is what a lyric should do, to the repetition of the word Jesus. And the song is the statement of Jesus' name in that song is like if I'm talking to my baby and I just say, you are just beautiful. Oh, you know, Lee, how did you even come to be? And that's the tone mm-hmm. of that word. And so it is meant for other people to hear, but it is also meant for you to, it was what I was singing in my mother's ear when she died. It was her favorite of our songs. And I just thought this will comfort her soul more than anything. And it did, because the name of Jesus is power when you need power. It's solace when you need comfort. It's stimulation when you need to go, get off your butt off the couch and go. Everything.
Yes. Yes.
Amen. And I know I got to share this story with you, but maybe your listeners haven't heard it. But that was the one song the night that I got to spend with our stillborn in my arms. I didn't know what to pray. I didn't know what to say. But as I held him in my arms, that was the song that came to me. And though it was really broken and heartbreaking, it was what passed through my lips as I had that time with our baby, even though he was in heaven already. It was the song that my mother sang to me, and I got to sing to him. And it is probably my favorite song on earth, just because it's come to mean so much. And I'm so grateful that you guys have lent your gifts, because those were gifts in my life.
Well, Becky, you know, as a good songwriter yourself, that the songs you write come out of your experience. Mm-hmm. And the reading part of that song are actual things in our lives. Bill's grandmother, who was just a precious woman, and she loved the Lord. But sometimes, you know, when people are dying, you excavate things that you have long forgotten, and some people uncharacteristically swear or cuss or mm-hmm. do stuff mm-hmm. in their delirium that you mm-hmm. like, where did that come from? Yeah. And when she was at that stage, what came from her lips was an old hymn, and she was repeating, she was not cognizant. But she was saying, Jesus, you are so precious to me. Jesus, you're so precious to me. And that's one of the places that song came from. And that is in the reading part about I've seen a dying saint, you know, mm-hmm. in her last ounce of ebbing strength to whisper her sweetest name. And our daughter, Suzanne, had chronic throat infections, tonsillitis, and she would spike fevers that were frightening, and we would hold her. And there were times I didn't know how to get the fever down. I mean, I did everything I knew to do it. And all I knew was to just say the name of Jesus, and her fever would break. And, you know, there's power in that simple name. I think we underestimate, actually, power in the name of Jesus. And you're right, Becky. He prays for us as we are in groanings that we can't utter. There's no words for them. Mm-hmm. And that's a language God understands. Somebody's written that song, too.
You know, one time when my daughter was three, she had a seizure. We were sitting on the couch, my wife and my daughter and I, and her eyes rolled back in her head and she started to convulse. And there was a nurse who lived down the street. So I ran straight out the door and yelled for Erica. And then as I was waiting for the ambulance, I was standing on the sidewalk saying, "Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, save my baby, Jesus," you know. And it wasn't like I consciously thought I need to do that. It just sprung out of me, you know. And so I think that when you talk about that, the power, the presence, I don't want to use the word magic, and yet that's kind of how it feels in a way, a mysterious holy magic that comes with saying the name of Jesus.
It's like grabbing hold of a lightning bolt. It's, you know, that electricity is always in the air. But there are times when the storms in our life make us have the courage, and people say, well, you know, wimps serve God. And I was like, no, you really serve God, and you've got a tiger by the tail. Mm-hmm. Holy Spirit can take you places that you never dreamed you'd be sufficient, aren't sufficient.
Absolutely.
But you get up to speak and you're saying things and you say, where did that come from?
Right.
Yes.
Right.
And only afterwards you hear your own words saying deeper truths than you knew.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, since Becky shared one, I want to share one too. My dad, the last 6 years of his life, he had Alzheimer's. And toward the end, even though I hadn't really wanted to, I got to the point where I thought he would be better served in a memory care facility. And the night before he went into that memory care facility, I happened to put on Because He Lives. And I have told you this, Gloria, but again, our listeners don't know this. He sang every single word of that entire song. It was like he was there for that moment in a way that he wasn't anymore in his life. So I know our listeners out there who are familiar with your catalog, I'm sure that all of them have stories. So just the fact that Becky and I could sit here and tell you how one of your songs has been so deeply personal, I can't imagine what that must feel like to know that there are countless stories like that out there. And I just bless you for your faithfulness as a lyricist to pour yourself out so that people could have those healing special moments.
You know, people ask us what are the most, you know, the high moments for us. And they said, was it when Elvis Presley recorded your song, or was it when, you know, certain things happened? And we always say, no, it's when you're in, let's say, Scotland or Ireland or the Scandinavian countries, and you start to sing something on the stage with microphones. Mm-hmm. And the audience takes it away from you and drowns you out in their language, singing with you as you're singing it in English. Mm. And suddenly you realize this is not our song.
Mm. Yes.
When the moments come when the song, you know, it belongs to the people. Yeah. Because of experiences like you're sharing that you had no idea how a song shows up in your life, and you shoot it out there. I love the poem by Kipling that says, I shot an arrow into the air, it fell to earth, I know not where. Mm-hmm. And then it's got the one, then I sang a song into the air. Mm-hmm. And you don't know where it's going to go. And it lands in places you would never, never dream. And when you're in an audience of 3,000 or 4,000 people, and all of them have an experience that makes them drown you out singing that song, that is the greatest thrill, is to say, it's not mine anymore.
You know, Gloria, this, that is so resonating. I haven't had the experience of having thousands of people sing my song, and I can't even imagine what that would feel like. But one time I was invited to sing in a woman's prison, and I happened to choose a song called I Choose Grace, that I knew that they'd been doing a book study and that song was in there. And when the women in the prison started singing I Choose Grace, I just came unglued. I burst into tears and slid off the stool and just put my head on the stool and cried, because I thought, if they're choosing grace with the life experiences they've had, that means something entirely different than what I was writing about.
Grace is deeper than you thought.
Exactly. Grace is deeper than I thought. And I just, so that's just one tiny experience, but I can imagine you've had that over and over and over again in different countries around the world.
This is what keeps you writing. And Becky, you know this because of the things you've written about losing your baby, how it resonates with people, and it digs out stories that you had never dreamed. But I think of two little scenarios in specifics. Someone that was on a mission in the deep Congo, and they were going down a river in some kind of a canoe to get to a remote village. And coming toward them was another boat of some kind full of natives in, you know, almost no dress, just paddling their canoe as they came down. And their first response was, are they going to be violent? Are they going to, you know, not accept us here in their country, on their river? What is going to happen? And when the boat got close enough that they could hear, they were singing Because He Lives.
Oh my gosh.
Oh my goodness.
As they rode down they couldn't understand the dialect at all, the language. But when they heard that melody, they turned around to each other and said, we're perfectly safe. This is the yes. Body of Christ.
Glory to God. You know, in those moments, I don't know. I'm just listening to this and I go, you know, I know just in the things I've experienced that you just feel so small and you feel so, I don't know, I guess honored is the word that, privileged that God would just choose to take a meager offering, because we know that anything without Him in it is just futile. So we could have the best written song, most brilliantly written lyrics, but it can't have the impact apart from the power of the Holy Spirit and Almighty God.
And that's what makes you, it's like standing by the ocean. I'm a water person, but I have to do that. I have to go to the ocean every once in a while to just say, you are a dot. You're not even a dot on the, you're a grain of sand, because look at the immensity. And you have to be reminded of the immensity that is not you.
Yes.
Every once in a while.
I think everybody should go to the Grand Canyon once in a while to be reminded of that.
Something grand. I love talking to you because you're both serious songwriters. And Steve, you have drawn together a group of serious songwriters who at some point in history said, I'm not going to write ditties. I'm going to take on topics that turn people's life upside down. Mm-hmm. And that is a brave thing to do, and also a non-commercial thing to do. You don't make a living digging into people's deepest souls.
Right.
But you do it anyway. And I do it anyway. You know, I remember when we first wrote It Is Finished, our producer said, nobody will ever get this song. He said, I get it, but people won't get this song and it'll never get radio play. And let me just tell you, hardly anything of ours has ever gotten radio play because it's more than 2 minutes long. The gatekeepers don't get it.
Right.
Won't go deep enough with you. You know, whatever the current criteria for playing a song on the radio. Mm-hmm. But that song was more than 4 minutes, and it was, and you couldn't cut it up because it's just the whole story of the crucifixion and what happened and what was going on cosmically. Mm-hmm. At that moment. And that song came from hearing a sermon, and Bill and I, that we were singing in the service, and this wonderful orator began to finish his sermon by saying, and a drop of blood fell from the cross and fell into the grain of sand below the cross and said to the grain of sand, it is finished. And the grain of sand said to a blade of grass, it is finished. And a bird swooped down and picked the blade of grass and carried it into the sky. And it said, it is finished. And he perched in the top of the pine tree. And the pine tree said to the sky, it is finished. And so he went, and Bill's punching me in the elbow. You know, he's going, we got to write this. We got to write this. This is amazing. And it was a very moving end to that, you know, the announcement that what was happening on the cross. And so after we left that service, he said, we got to write that. That was amazing. And great orators can do that to you.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And that's what poetry does. It just, you know, it goes someplace in your inner sanctum. So for the next week or so, he said, have you thought anything about that, you know, that idea? Have you written anything about that idea? And I said, what was finished? And he said, well, you know, redemption's plan and all that. And I said, I can't write it yet. And two things happened. We were sitting in our living room and the soldiers were coming home from Vietnam, and Vietnam was the, you know, greatest hell probably since the Civil War. And the guys were coming down the plane, the steps from the plane, and falling on the ground and kissing the dirt of America. Yeah. And wives were bringing their little children that were 2 and 3 years old that the fathers had never seen. And they were just weeping. And we were silent. This was so moving. And these are the soldiers that got spat on in the streets when they went out in public.
Yes.
And so that was the tearing apart of the country was very similar to what happened 2 years ago with the burning down of the cities and all that anger. So we're watching all that. And then I picked up a Newsweek or something like that and looked at the cover, and there was a soldier in army fatigues and with holding a rusty rifle or gun of some kind. So I turned to the story, and the story was this man had stumbled out of the jungle in one of the South Pacific islands into civilization. And he said, are they gone? Are they gone? And they said, who's gone? The Japanese, are they gone? And he had been guarding that island all those years till his rifle was rusted and he was not a young man. And this battered uniform was still hanging on his body. And they said to him, that war was won 20 years ago. And those two images clicked in my mind. And I said, that's me. You know, I'm fighting a war that's already been won. Mm. And Satan has no power over me except to convince me that the war has never been won. And so those two images, you know, then that's wrote because the it is finished. And no, Becky, it never got radio play because it was 4 minutes long. And the producer was wrong. People were smart enough to get that song. Mm-hmm. In fact, it was very personal to so many songs, and it became one of our biggest songs. So you back to what you guys are doing with Music for the Soul, you're taking the risk to say, I may not make a living, but I can make a statement, and I can speak to the deepest recesses of people's broken hearts, and I can take on the after effects of abortion. I can take on cancer that makes you lose your hair and your life. I can take on a suicide in my family, and I can ask God, give me some meaning for this. Mm-hmm. And you have taken on the hard stuff, and I'm just telling you, keep doing it. Only the people that hear it are the people who are broken by it, well, isn't that what you started out to do?
Yes. Yes. Thank you, Gloria.
Thank you.
You know, you have a song called Hurt by Hurt, and there's a lyric line in there. I built the wall one hurt at a time. Mm. And when I saw that lyric line, it made me immediately think, when I was thinking about doing Music for the Soul, I had this vision of someone sitting in front of a brick wall. Mm-hmm. And on the other side of the wall was light. and I could see the light seeping through the cracks in the wall.
Right, yeah.
And I thought, that's what music does.
It is.
We build a wall of our defenses, but the music can seep through the cracks in those walls. And before we even know it, it has our heart and it softens our heart and opens it up. And now we can lay a healing melody and a healing message. And of course, we know about the memory power of a melody in a way that somebody can remember and carry with them. And once I saw that, I thought, okay, that's what we're doing. That's what we're doing. And it was such a blessing to see that lyric line in your song and think, okay, if Gloria thinks that's it, then I think I'm on to something. Yeah.
You know, that I can't take credit for that idea. And she took criticism for it. Jimmy Carter's sister wrote a book about it. It was before the church was even dealing with, you know, if you went to a psychologist, that there's something wrong with your heart. You know, you weren't a very good Christian.
Right.
And now we have come farther enough. And she was one of the first people to say, deciding to follow God is one thing, but tackling all those things in your life that have been deep hurts and deep scars, you built that wall one brick at a time. Mm-hmm. And you need to walk back through that. And I don't know if she, this is my words, I guess, when I read what she was saying, but she said, a counselor will help you know that Jesus was there all the time. Mm. He was there at the beginning of the worst hurt, the first offense, the first time you were molested, the first time somebody, you know, maligned you, whatever the beginning was, Jesus was there. Now let him walk you back through all the stuff that you have built since then to keep yourself safe. All the bricks of walls that you have built one brick at a time, he will help you unbrick those.
Yes.
And help you know that he was there in the beginning. He loved you as a child. You were always worthy. You were always beautiful. You were always his.
Yes.
Now let's work back to that. And you're going to need some counseling to do that because you need somebody to walk with you. It's scary. This is scary business. What will happen if I unbrick that? But you need help. You need a companion.
Yes, you
to
do.
Help you do that.
One pastor said to me when I was first starting Music with a Soul, be careful, you need to melt people's walls, not blow them up. And when you talk about taking down the wall one brick at a time with Jesus' help, that feels more like a melting, a nourishing way of engaging with the pain rather than just blowing it out of the water and leaving somebody vulnerable.
You're not going to dynamite it. Yeah.
I love that too, just because, you know, you build a wall brick by brick. So why would you expect to just get rid of the entire wall all at once? And I think so often we think, I want to be quick about this. I just want to bulldoze it all over. But there's value to taking each brick and allowing our great physician God to heal each and every one of them and to clean up the mortar that's been stuffed in those cracks to hold it all together. And so I know a lot of people are very afraid to dismantle that wall because it's become a fortress, or even as painful as it is, it's kind of a safety just having it there. But this is, your words could not be more encouraging today for those who are sitting there just afraid to begin the disassembly, but it can become the most freeing and the most beautiful experience to be set free from being trapped in those walls. And I loved, you have a quote that says, a sermon won't do it, a book won't do it. When you're going down for the third time, it's a song that rescues you. And I just, amen, amen, amen. And it's, I know it's one of Steve's favorite quotes and it's one of mine too. So what do you think, in your opinion, makes songs so powerful? What is it about them?
I've had many people say, I wish I could write like you write. And I'm saying, in my spirit, I'm saying, no, you don't. Because to do that, you have to agree to feel everything everybody feels. and you have to feel it poignantly. And that is a vulnerability. I think it's easier to write a song to God and just say, God, you're awesome. God, you're awesome. God, you're awesome. Mm-hmm. My cynical soul sitting in church, hearing all that. And I believe in praise and I believe in worship. I'm a deep believer in both. But I'm sitting there with my life and my children and my grandchildren and our stories and the people in my life and the people that have put there by God, my neighbors and people that have stories. And when I hear a congregation over and over say, God, you're awesome. God, you're awesome. I'm sitting there saying, how do you know that? You better tell me how you know that. Because if you don't, I got Monday morning coming down. Mm-hmm. For every vertical song, there has to be a horizontal living out. How mm-hmm. then shall we live?
Yes.
That mm-hmm. is true. If God is awesome, how then shall we live? And how does this apply to my Monday morning? So I want, for every praise and worship song, I want a testimonial song that mm-hmm. says, this is how I know. Mm-hmm. God is awesome because this is what he did.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
What he did in me is what he did in my family. It's what he did to my marriage. It is what I did to my neighbor. Mm-hmm. You know, and if you don't tell me that, I don't want to go to church and be reminded that somebody thinks God is awesome and I have no idea how to connect to him.
Yes. I've felt for a long time that in worship, it's wonderful to be looking up and praising God and to right. receiving God's love. But what about the person to your right or the person to your left? One of them might be thinking about going home and taking their own life. And you leave the congregation and you haven't even spoken to them. I think that idea of horizontal worship completes this triangle of love, with God's love flowing down to the person on either side of you and your concern flowing out, not just up to God, but to the person on either side of you. And just this connectivity, it feels like real community to me. Whereas what you're describing of everybody just going straight up, that's only God. Scripture says the greatest commandment, love God and who? Your neighbor. So we got the first part right, but we don't focus enough on the second part, do we?
I think the verse from the book of Revelation, one of the final comments we have about all this whole Bible is, we overcome. And it's discovered, it is in the context of horrible disintegration of the earth and the mm-hmm. culture. But John said, we overcome by the word, the blood of the Lamb. That's vertical, and the word of our testimony.
Amen.
And I think in our worship, we have to have equal parts of both. But I love that, because the blood of the Lamb, you know, you can put that on the doorpost of your car, the doorpost of your house, the doorpost of your kid's room at college, the doorpost of, you know, your husband's workplace. We can put the blood of the Lamb on the doorposts of our life. But having been salvaged from the death angel and by the blood of the Lamb, that symbol is, we are rescued from death, all kinds of death. Mm-hmm. It has no power over us. But then we are rescued for something. We are rescued to then take our families and take our lives and take our neighbors and share this amazing truth, because they're going down for the third time too. And I don't want to throw a buoy to somebody drowning that isn't tied to the boat.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm. So good. So good. And the testimony part, I don't know about you, but every time I hear a story where you can see so evidently God working, it grows my faith. It encourages my faith. It makes me look expectantly for those moments in my life and look back and remember and rejoice. And then we find ourselves rejoicing on a vertical sense again. And then as we share horizontally again, the power of the word of God and the power of his work, it's just incredible, how it grows and grows.
Absolutely. Praise, scripturally, praise is always a result, not a cause.
Mm-hmm.
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 It is a result of our interfacing with any one of the great biblical truths of salvation, forgiveness, healing, confession, witnessing. All of those things will produce, as you said, Becky, the result of, oh my, I can't believe how awesome you are, God. I can't believe how you showed up. Where did that come from? And then, you know, that praise gives us courage to go and take on another person or another situation instead of staying in our secluded cocoon of the church. We all love the womb. We all love that fellowship, and we all need it. We need it. We need it. But we need it so that we can be empowered to go out again. And we come to church to say, who is this God we serve? And then we have to encourage each other. And encouragement, as you said, is key to that. I've got to encourage the person beside me to say, don't be afraid. I have a thing about flimsy angels on people's, you know, lapel, because we don't have any biblical proof that any little cherub that drifts around on pink clouds is how angels are. Every time anybody in scripture saw one, the first thing the angel said was, fear not, because they're on their face in fear because of these awesome messengers of God. But our encouragement says, like an angel would say to the prophet, I appreciate that, but get up off your face. Get up off your face and go. That's what he said. Get up off your face and go. Fall on your face, because, you know, this is awesome power. The power of God is an awesome thing, and it is not predictable, and you can't control it, and it will take you scary places, and it will make you take risks you thought were insane, you know?
Yes.
But this power is awesome enough to say, I am empowering you. This is not just for you to sit around and enjoy the light. The light moves. Mm-hmm. Scripture says the light moves. You stay in the light. Walk in the light. Mm-hmm. If you don't, the light's going to move and you're not going to be in it. Mm-hmm. The adventure of God is us walking in the light. Yes. And we are not going to see 10 miles down the road. We're going to see the light on our path right now. So keep moving, because the light is moving.
Becky, I know that you talked to some people and had some friends who had some questions for Gloria. Are there any of those that we haven't covered that you think maybe we could ask her? I'd be curious what other people wanted to know.
Well, first of all, I had quite a few say, just tell her we love her so much. So
that's not a question.
You're great. We love her. I promised I would relay this to her. So, but I was like, hey, if you could ask Gloria Gaither anything, what would it be? And I have to say, we'll never be able to cover all the questions, but I did promise that I would convey their great love for you. And honestly, just all the gratitude that's out there for sharing your gifts and sharing your life, really. And that one person asked, you know, what is something you had to sacrifice to do what you and Belle have done over the years? And would you do it again? Or what would you do different? You kind of wanted to know how, you know, being in the limelight, if you will, how that affects you. And would you say that there have been some sacrifices, and what would they be? And how would you change it if you could?
Honestly, God's been so good to us that I don't consider anything a sacrifice. And the other thing I've learned is he doesn't ever ask you to violate the primary relationships in your life to serve him.
Good.
Those are my primary responsibilities. My parents, that they die well and can serve God as long as they breathe. It was my responsibility to make sure that my ministering parents never had to quit ministering because of some negligence on my part. And I think the second thing is my siblings. I have my sister Evelyn and her children. Now I have one of her daughters back in her house that my mother and dad built across the creek from us. So her grandmother and her mother both lived in that house. Now she and her husband have retired from the ministry, and they have bought the house back.
Ah.
And, so I have her, and I feel like she's my other daughter. Those are, she has two wonderful kids, and they are my responsibility. You know, they're part of my life. Bill and his family are my primary responsibility. And our traveling, I mean, bless Bill. He has been amazing in managing. We were home all during the week. I fixed breakfast for the kids. We had supper around our table. The kids, we allowed them to be in two major extracurricular activities. And so we did ball games and we did music lessons and we did horseback riding and all the stuff that kids bring into your life. But those are my responsibilities. Travel, we kept our traveling to weekends, which I wouldn't have done had my mother not lived across the creek. And basically she moved in and out of my house and her house to help my kids go on with their regular lives in a regular town. I'm not saying that our pattern is right for everybody, but I will say God doesn't ask you to trash your relationships to serve him.
Amen.
That's not how he works.
One of the other questions was, who would you say your greatest musical influencer is?
Well, my influencers are mostly lyrical. One is Stuart Hamlin, who Bill and I both also used his lyrics in our literature classes for American literature because he is such an amazing poet. This old house, for instance, the way he used an empty house that he came across riding out. He is a horseback rider. He's a cowboy. And we've been to his house up on the mountain, up there where the Hollywood sign is, where he kept his horses. And there's lots of fun stories about him being a cowboy in Hollywood. But his imagery of this old house, that lyric is just genius for American poetry. And this is a lyric of his, for instance, that I love. The tramp on the street, homeless and weak, could be I, but for the grace of God. Mm. The steel of my soul could have wrinkled and bent had I traveled the byways he's trod. O wonderful God, O merciful Father, O wonderful God, thy hands have spared me these things. May my heart know compassion as a child when she holds a bird with a broken wing. Oh, Lord, make me strong, not to boast of my strength, but to lend it to the weak and downtrod. May I always remember things dear to my heart are mine to hold only by the grace of God. He taught me two things there. That is an incredible lyric, incredible poetry, credible metaphor. You can take it apart in any way, but he's using every device possible to do a lyric that you never notice that he's using device.
Mm-hmm.
Billy Joel does the same thing. And he was another one that I taught actually and made me, those writers made me believe that people, the audience is smarter than you think. And the audience can follow you past the end of one line into the next line, past the end of that line into the next line, past the end of that line into another line. They can follow you. They don't need four word sentences because they're so dumb.
Mm-hmm.
They're not dumb and their experiences are deep. And if you say it right, they can follow you as far and as deep as you want to take them. So those were huge influences on my life. Fanny Crosby, who wrote thousands of lyrics, only probably you could maybe count 10 if you stretched yourself. I wonder where all those others are. Do you know that Wheaton has Fanny Crosby's catalog of lyrics in their archives? Don't you think one of those kids that plays a guitar would be going into those archives and see if maybe one other than 10 of those Americans, she never wrote a note of music. She was a
lyricist. That would be worth somebody's time for sure.
Mm-hmm. Where are the guitar kids that want to say, well, surely there was another amazing lyric in, you know, 1,000 or so that she wrote. You know, she influenced me, mainly people, great poets in songwriting, lyricists, that taught me that the audience is smart. If you say it right, they can get the deepest things, including children. I think we've written some of our most profound things for children. I am a promise. I'm a possibility. I'm a promise. You know, the theorists back then, educators, said a child can't understand anything more than one syllable words. And I said, that's crazy. They go around singing supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
That's right.
They're smarter than you think.
Oh, that's so great. Yeah. That's so great.
Okay, there was one of my other favorites. I am a promise. And I have finally forgiven Bill for singing God loves to talk to little boys while they're fishing, because I used to like to fish.
Me too. I fished my whole life.
I love it.
Bill didn't. He didn't fish. I fished. I'm the one that taught all our kids to fish. And I think my mother would have sent me back if I hadn't put the night crawler on my own hook.
Oh, yes. That's a thing in our house, too. And you know what? Dave, my husband, does not fish, but I do. And so Grace, my little Gracie,
he didn't
and I,
write in fact, that. I did. But the reason I wrote it was we were messing around the piano, looking out our window one day. Now we have so much a forest around our house that we planted that I couldn't have seen it. But there was a little boy down at the creek at our pond fishing. And he was just the orneriest kid in the neighborhood. And Bill said, who's down there? And I told him, I said, well, that's so-and-so. And he said, well, he's been down there for an hour. And I said, yeah, fishing will do that to you. And that's how God loves to talk to little boys while they're fishing.
I love it.
The time boys listen best. It's the only quiet time there is for listening. It's the only time when God and boys can rest.
Yeah.
So it was because it was an ornery little boy, and that does not discriminate against all the women.
I heard that story. That's when the forgiveness came. So good. Yeah, Grace kept me outside on a Mother's Day morning. It was 40 degrees out, and she insisted she kept me out at that pond for 2.5 hours. So she loves it even more than I do.
One of my best fishing memories with Benji is we had catfish in our pond, and they don't start biting till about dusk. And it was dusk and it was raining, and we were catching catfish like crazy, and it was lightning. And I said, we should probably go in. And Benji said, we can't go in. We're catching catfish now. So I just went and got a plastic tablecloth that was in the gazebo and put it over a picnic table, and we crawled under the picnic table and kept on fishing.
What a great memory. I love it.
Well, Gloria, this conversation has been such a blessing. Mm-hmm. So much wisdom, so many great stories. Is there anything you'd like to let our listeners know, a place where they could reach you or something you're working on that you'd like to share with them?
Well, I would love to share the blog that I'm doing, and you can just put in Google lovesongtomylife.com. And I do it, probably every 10 days or so, every kind of topic all over the map. But it's kind of like our conversation today. any good thing that comes up, from fishing to what was going on in the cross, there's no subjects off limit. And I'd love for you to join me there, make comments and let me know what you think. lovesongtomylife.com.
I have to say that it comes to my inbox on a regular basis, and I enjoy it thoroughly. It's a wealth of sweet goodness coming in through the email amidst all of my coupons and spam. It's a joy to see that.
That people could find our music also if you just go to Gaither Music. There's Gaither Music Facebook. There's Gaither Music on iTunes. Or if you like a particular song, just put the name of the song / Gaither, and it will find it for you.
Terrific. I know Becky won't want us to sign off without asking your favorite question, right, Becky? If she had one thing.
My one thing. Yes.
Yes.
If you had one thing to encourage aspiring songwriters, what would it be?
Don't settle for shallow.
I love that. That's very specific. Yeah. There's no way to misinterpret what she just said.
That's enough. And thank you for Music for the Soul, because you certainly did not settle for shallow.
Thank you so much, Gloria.
We love you dearly, and you are just precious, a precious gift to my life. I think of you all the time. It's hard for me not
to connect with you a lot more than what I do. But just know that you are dearly loved, I know, by many, but by us and by me. And just thank you. Thank you. So grateful for you. And thank you for spending your time with us today. I know many will be blessed because of our conversation with you today.
Oh, thank you. It was fun, pure fun. I love this. I love this kind of conversation.
Terrific. Thank you.
Well, if you enjoyed the podcast today, share it with a friend and give us a positive review on iTunes.
And please visit our website, musicforthesoul.org, where you can stream or download every song in our catalog, read our lyrics, our healing music guide, our blog posts, and more. Thank you so much for listening. God bless.
I am a promise. I am a possibility. I am a promise with a capital P. I can be anything, anything God wants me to be.
You are a promise. You are a possibility. You are a promise with a capital P. You are a great big bundle of potentiality. And if you listen, you'll hear God's voice. And if you're trying, He'll help you make the right choices. You're a promise to be anything God wants you to be.
You know something? It doesn't matter what your name is, or where you live, or who your daddy is, or how big you are, or what you look like. Hey, what do you look like? Are you short, tall, fat, skinny, got holes in your tennis shoes and freckles on your nose? It doesn't matter a bit. You can be exactly what God wants you to be, and He has something very special in mind for you. It might be climbing mountains or sailing the sea, helping sick people get well, or singing a song. Whatever it is, you can do it.
You can go anywhere that He wants you to go. You can be anything that He wants you to be. You can climb the high mountain, you can cross the wide sea. You're a great promise, you see.
I am a promise. I am a possibility. I am a promise with a capital P. I am a great big bundle of potentiality. And I am learning to hear God's voice, and I am trying to make the right choices. I'm a promise to be.
Hear God's voice and keep on trying. He'll help you make the right choice. You're a promise to be anything He wants you to be.
I'm a promise to be anything God wants me to
be. We're a promise to be
anything,
anything He wants us to be.